right. Welcome to History of Heroes, where we detail the storied pasts of your favorite intrepid adventurers from before they joined the table and became part of our evolving world. Today's hero is Angela Hawthorne. If you've wondered who is that ponytailed crusader who's always right up in the thick of things, then this one's for you. Angela Hawthorne came into the world as the middle child of a loving family. Her father, Arthur, was a ranking officer in the city guard of Waterdeep. Though his duties in the trades ward kept him busier than most, he still managed to be an attentive father and a faithful husband. Come hell or high water, you'd rarely see him set aside the needs of his family. The brown-haired man was of strong stature and noble demeanor, but not in the false fashion of so many members of quote-unquote true nobility. His dedication to justice was as firm as his jawline, and his willingness to roll up his sleeves and do the hard work alongside his men seemed to inspire those who served under him, and exhaust those who outranked him, who often had to pull him away from what they considered menial tasks to remind him of the responsibilities of his rank. The duty he felt to the city and his men was strongly rooted, but his sense of duty to his family was that much stronger. He would have gotten along well with Dom Toretto, I think. Angela's mother, Sabine, was originally of House Than, a well-known group of vintners and landowners with an unsavory past. She herself had fallen quite far from the tree, though, and embraced a life of civil service along with her husband, despite her family disowning her for marrying a man not of noble blood, placing love over politics. She bore that excommunication with pride, knowing that she had done the right thing, and threw herself into building up the community around her and caring for her children. In her free time, Sabine loved to paint, often able to be seen through the large rose window that peeked the home she and her husband had rebuilt together. The circumstances surrounding Angela's birth weren't normal by any stretch of the imagination. A tale her parents never told her, as they didn't want to worry their children. In 1474, as the time came for Sabine's second child to be born, Arthur had his home targeted by a group of smugglers he was investigating, and the family had to go into hiding. Under great duress, Sabine turned to the only family who she knew would help, her brother, Malark. When she'd been disowned, Malark had defended her, being disowned himself for daring to stand by his sister. He had found a much different path than his sibling, though, finding himself embroiled among the criminal underworld and the Xanathar Guild. He uses his magic to transform into a dire lynx, leading small bands of rogues in and below the streets of Waterdeep. Sabine asked for his assistance in her time of need, and Arthur, despite knowing the man's questionable morals, agreed to go under the man's protection for the safety of his wife and children. Such was Malark's pull with the guild that when they went underground, they went deep. Being brought to Skullport blinded, it was here that Sabine gave birth to Angela, with Midna Talberth, the guild's priestess of Shar, staying by her side as midwife. At Malark's urging, Midna performed the same ritual upon the Hawthorns that she'd performed on all elite members of the guild, helping to shield them from the prying eyes of those who would divine their location. Though far from foolproof, it was to magical sensors like a cloak is to the eyes of a guard, allowing the skilled to slip by undetected and unobserved. This precaution was, however, a guild secret, and a gift that the Xanathar did not part with willingly, and his displeasure cost Malark the ability to return to his human form. The man takes this change in stride, assuming the role of the family pet in the Hawthorne house during the day, the family's home near the river gate on Wall Way, and executing his master's dark will by night in the shadows of the city. With that, life was good for a time, and Angela grew into a strong girl with pale blonde hair, a stark contrast to her father, but one that suited her just right. In 1483, Sabine gives birth to another child, this time a boy, and Timothy joins the family tree. In 1484, Arthur begins to lead patrols in other districts of the city, and with their father busy, well, Angela always had enjoyed exploring the docks. It is there that she befriended Marcus, the son of a popular glassblower in the dock ward. It isn't long before the pair of them find themselves in trouble when they trust the claims of a stranger who convinces them to trespass onto the property of one Madame de Carrios, claiming he'd left something of his own behind and needed them to retrieve it. On their way through the abode, they encounter a tressim, a winged cat rarely seen in this part of the world. Madame de Carrios captures the pair, who plead their innocence to her and the city guard, and by the time Arthur arrives, the worried man finds all already in hand. The Madame, knowing Marcus's father, assures the guards no harm has been done, and she bears no grudge. What's more, she had seen the sheer wonder in the young man's brightly shining eyes, and over the next month takes him on as an apprentice, eventually finding him a place in the Blackstaff Academy of Magic to stoke his magical spark. The joys of those early years serve as fond memories to the pair of them to this day. Witnessing Marcus's first cantrips, her playful duel with a harbor master, and always begging Arthur to accompany him on patrols, she truly was the apple of her father's eye, her elder sister taking more to sewing and dancing than she, and it seemed like these good times could never end. The years that followed, however, were much darker. In 1487, Angela was awoken by the sounds of fear within her family home, and booted footsteps tromped angrily through the house. By the time she emerged, armed men had already taken her father into custody, appearing in the dead of night fully armed and armored. The men wore no emblems, but claimed to be servants of the Lords of Waterdeep, arresting Arthur for crimes against the city, and promising, should he be innocent, he would be released quickly. Though Sabine wanted to believe it, Angela could feel that the man was deceiving her, and fled through the startled guards to try and make them release her father. Unfortunately, one of them seized her before she could reach him, and the last she saw of the man, the strong Aomar of the Trade Ward, was him defeated in the back of a caged wagon, head lowered as she screamed and commanded him to break free and come home. He never did. The next years of the Hawthorne House saw only one goal, and that was to make sure that Arthur was freed from imprisonment. Each child of the house did their best to help, as Sabine and her brother, who now posed as the woman's familiar, demanded the intervention of every authority they could reach. After 8 long months of begging and lobbying, they had nothing to show for it, except for a laundry list of confused, angry, and impotent bureaucrats. Early in Mertul, on the way back from another fruitless meeting, tragedy struck once again, having not yet had its fill of the family. A Shar-worshipping assassin fell upon Sabine and her brother, and though the Dire Lynx was able to fend the attackers off, he was mortally wounded. Malark finally returned to his human form that night, just as he drew his last breath. Linked by strange magics, Sabine began to waste away as well. Over the next few days, she bid her children farewell, and then perished herself. In one fatal swipe, the Hawthorne House had no guidance, and even less hope. Cecily returned home and shuttered her own budding business, dedicating herself to becoming the new matriarch of the family. While her elder sister and little brother comforted each other, Angela wants only one thing: the truth. Now unshackled by her mother's more reasoned and safe approach, Angela uses her friends in the dock ward to track down the assassin, but finds him already gone, having fled to the Moonshay Isles, an archipelago in the trackless sea. Not willing to let the one who killed her mother and uncle flee justice like those who took her father, she takes up his sword, cuts her hair, and signs on with a crew headed in that direction. It is there that Angela begins her career in piracy, and though it is short-lived and nearly bloodless, it was nonetheless entertaining. She made the mistake of signing up to serve under Captain Helena, a famously misandristic captain. Not knowing that, she quickly manufactures a male alias, thinking that surely only men do piracy. Helena, immediately seeing through her guise, has one of the greatest laughs of her entire career, and welcomes the curiously named Guybrush Threepwood on board her vessel, sure that he will make waves one day as a mighty pirate. Her name was most definitely not taken by seeing a guy brushing the deck and another deckhand carrying three pieces of wood. Guybrush's travels are an eye-opening experience, as there is much to be learned for a first-time pirate out at sea. Thankfully, Helena's preference for boarding actions and surprise attacks means the young warrior is spared the worst of the trackless sea. At long last, she manages to track her mother's killer to a specific island. What she finds when she arrives there, however, is that the killer has already paid the ultimate price for his crimes, though not the ones she sought to bring him to justice for. He had failed to eliminate the remaining members of the Hawthorne family, and now the authorities were on too high an alert for them to act again. Instead, the cult of Shar assassins chose to cover up their failure, claiming to their mysterious employer that the job had been completed and tying up their last loose end, the failing assassin himself. Angela was left with only the weapon of his demise, a broken dagger made of hollow glass that had been filled with a deadly poison. With nothing else to go on, she had to swallow her pride and return with only the knowledge that the instrument of her mother's demise had paid, but not the conspirator who had caused it. She returns to the Ivory Web and her captain with some satisfaction, but she still yearns for a much greater justice. To this end, she departs the vessel the next time they dock in Waterdeep and heads home. It is at this point, after another few years of taking minor mercenary gigs to clear basements of rats or to chase off livestock thieves, that she finds herself sitting in the yawning portal. When the Lords of Waterdeep announced the appearance of the chests, she had made her desire to join one of the parties going into Undermountain known to her siblings. And after much urging from Cecily, she agreed to allow one of her father's colleagues to accompany her. Beth and Yell had been a fast friend to Arthur, despite their enormous age difference, and though he often treats Angela as if she's going to break should she step onto an unstable stair, it is nice to feel like someone is looking out for her. He is also a skilled healer, and served in the volunteer force that Waterdeep sent to aid the dwarves of the Silver Marches. Though the only major battle that their contingent participated in was a disaster, the orcs routing the dwarf forces in the Battle of the Cold Vale, Arthur spoke highly of his elven friend, and Angela puts her trust in him. Together, they seek out like-minded souls, with Angela confident they can gain the notoriety and wealth necessary to find and free her father from bondage once and for all. She can feel that he is alive, and being her father's daughter, she will never forsake him. And it is here that her history ends and a new journey begins, in episode 1 of The Best Available. I hope that knowing her roots will make her journey that much more riveting to watch unfold. And if waiting for our monthly episode releases isn't enough for you, it doesn't stop here. DOODLEPOODLE, our long-suffering artist who makes much of this beauty, has his own webcomic following Angela's adventures in another timeline where she never joined the Best Available. You can find a link to the Tales from the Tables in the description, and if you would be so kind as to support him, we would be very grateful. The more support he gets, the closer he is to being able to quit his job and make his comic full-time. We're pulling for you, Doodle! And as you consider that, allow me to go over the list of the amazing people that made this video possible, starting with the folks in the power tier, like David, DoodlePoodle, Jay Jones, John the Wicked, and William Smith. In the planar tier, we have CJ, Darth Cavalier, Gordy Danky, Ice Dragon, Jesse LaBrie, Joshua Williams, Sparkle Lord the Fabulous. In the adventurer tier, we have All Is Fiction, Bastion Falconrath, Dragon Tempest, John R300, Justin, Katie, Mystics, Sneaky GI, Sue Crash, Ty Korzak, and V. In the Questgiver tier, we have Bird or the Cage, Eminon, Kyla, Night Archer, ODST Hero, PPNTT807, Robert Mischief, Rio1990, Samantha, Sephiroth Kurosame, and Slaythar Silcom. And in the Townsfolk tier, we have Adrian, Blizzard Hawk, Biz Adrian, Dylan Taylor, DoodlePoodle, Ice Commander, Enrique, Matis, Okada, Scott Stedman, Sergeant Humpty, Shugenja, Tom Brazo, and Wicked Ways. And a special mention, of course, as always, to Scion of Magnus and Sammy Wolf. And as always, we can't forget our crew here. DoodlePoodle, Nala Fontaine, Shadow Wolf, Scorpius187, MC underscore Cheshire, Thriving Inferno, and the Forever DM, me. Until next time, take care of yourselves, take care of each other, and I will see you in the next one. Good night, all.